This week on Cracked Science, how a food scientist fell from grace and the unsung heroes that used numbers to call him out. Hey, this is Jonathan Jarry, and you're watching Cracked Science, the show from the McGill Office of Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. Scientists often state that science corrects itself. It's what differentiates science from dogma, and it's how we went from telling people with stomach ulcers they were just stressed to prescribing them antibiotics. But making course corrections in science can be messy, especially when we're right in the middle of one. And boy, are we in the middle of a significant course correction in the field of food psychology. Meet Dr. Brian Wansink.
I'm kind of a food psychologist, and I study why people do what they do when it comes to food, but more importantly, what can be done to help people eat better.
This guy has an impressive CV. He's a professor at Cornell University. He has written two general public books on how we eat. He has been on numerous television shows. And he was appointed by the White House 10 years ago to lead the US dietary guidelines. And the reason is probably because his research is easily digested and concerns the thing we love most, food and our relationship to it. For example, he showed that people who pay less for a lunch buffet end up feeling more physically uncomfortable and guiltier after the meal, even though they ate the same as someone who paid twice as much. He also published a paper showing that putting Elmo stickers on apples got school children to pick those more often than cookies at lunchtime. These kinds of findings became part of the Smarter Lunchroom movement, an initiative funded by the US government to nudge students into making better food choices in their lunchroom. And the program has been implemented in over 30,000 American schools. Brian Wansink also has a blog, and this is where the story gets particularly juicy. Because you see, Brian Wansink stopped blogging in March 2017. And if you go to his blog, you won't know why he suddenly stopped blogging, because the blog post that started this massive course correction has been deleted. Unfortunately for Brian Wansink, while many of us forget what we had for breakfast, the internet never forgets anything. The now deleted but archived forever blog post is Brian's story of the hardworking, and I quote, Turkish woman who came to his lab for 6 months and was given data from a failed study that came up negative. Wansink writes that he told her, "This costs us a lot of time and our own money to collect. There's got to be something here we can salvage because it's a cool, rich, and unique data set." After torturing the data enough, it confessed and they got positive results out of this study, and this led to the publication of 5 scientific papers. Wansink frames this as a success story, that hard work combined with proper time management leads to winning. The comments, however, were merciless. One guy wrote, "Is this a tongue-in-cheek satire of the academic process, or are you serious?" Another wrote, "I really hope this story is a joke. If not, your behavior is one of the biggest causes of the proliferation of junk science and psychology, and you are the one who should be shamed." Yet another summed it up pithily, "The quality of the literature takes another hit, but at least your lab got 5 papers out." Wansink's approach here, of which he was initially rather proud, is not how we do rigorous science, and may in fact be one of the reasons why so many scientific studies can't be reproduced. If you analyze the data in hundreds of different ways, you're going to get a positive signal just by chance, the same way that you can find you have something weird in common with a total stranger if you ask them enough questions, but it doesn't mean we're all connected. This single blog post triggered an investigation that has to this day resulted in the following. 45 of Wansink's published articles, which have in total been cited by other researchers over 4,000 times, are alleged to contain problems ranging from minor ones to very serious issues. These articles have been published in a total of 25 scientific journals and span over 20 years of research. Now, if I ask you who is leading this investigation, odds are you would say, why, Cornell University, of course, or some sort of science police that doesn't exist, but wouldn't it be nice if it did? The actual answer is the data detectives. You won't see them on Good Morning America talking about their latest research or on Jimmy Kimmel Live like they're the cast from the latest Star Wars. But they are the real scientists in this story, so allow me to show you their faces. They are Jordan Anaya, Tim Van Der Zee, Nick Brown, and James Heathers, with a special mention to Chris Chambers. When Wansink's blog post came out, Jordan Anaya saw it and looked at the papers that Wansink's lab had published out of this data torture session. And Anaya saw something that apparently the scientists who reviewed the paper before it was published failed to notice, and it was something to do with math. Now, before you reach for the pause button, let me reassure you that I will not give you a math lesson. Take it easy, put the mouse down, good. I will simply say that numbers have a way of revealing hidden truths when you know how to look at them in the right way. And Anaya did, and he noticed that the way in which these numbers were rounded, like when we go from 2.47 to 2.5, was mathematically impossible. Even more obvious than this, when he and Nick Brown looked at the same data published in two different Wansink papers, they noticed a great deal of inconsistencies. Unbeknownst to Wansink, these data detectives had a weapon, a twin set of programs they had developed called Grimm and Grimmer that automated the process of looking for these mathematical impossibilities. When the team published their results, they had found 150 inconsistencies or impossibilities in four of the five papers published by Wansink and the Turkish lady. Now, Wansink initially defended himself in the comment section to his blog post by calling this data torture a deep data dive and figuring out why our results don't look as perfect as we want. The problem is that A, you do run a high risk of finding false positives, and B, if you're going to publish this at all, it needs to be clear that this is exploratory work that needs to be replicated in an experiment designed to specifically test this new hypothesis. And yet, where do we find Elmo stickers? On the website of the Smarter Lunchrooms program aimed at elementary and middle schools. You would think that Cornell University's response in all of this would have been swift and reassuring, but it wasn't. They initially gave no response to the data detectives when their investigation was published online. When Cornell's own Office for Research Integrity received an email from them asking for the raw data from Wansink's study, they said that it was up to Brian Wansink himself to determine if he wanted to share it with them. Meanwhile, the ethics office that approved these studies at Cornell was silent to email prodding. Cornell finally conducted an internal review and concluded that Wansink's errors did not constitute scientific misconduct. As I remind you that so far, five of Wansink's papers have been retracted, 13 have received corrections, and more continue to be retracted to this day. You may wonder if this constitutes fraud. The answer at this point is, we don't know. But it helps to look at his CV, because while you may assume that he is a nutritionist or an experimental psychologist by training, he isn't. Brian Wansink has a bachelor's in business administration, a master's in journalism, and a PhD in marketing. And this makes me think that maybe he was just incompetent at his job and didn't surround himself with the right people to design rigorous experiments and analyze the data honestly. And it bears spelling out that everything Wansink reported as true, such as kids preferring apples with Elmo stickers to sticker-free apples, is not necessarily wrong. It's simply that we don't know if it's true. We're back at square one. This ongoing saga is making many experts question what we thought we knew about people's eating habits and their relationship to food. And I choose to see the bright side to this. This is a great example of science correcting itself. And it happened because real scientists, people who care about rigor and intellectual honesty, spend their spare time wading through a mountain of numbers to hold one superstar scientist accountable to the very data that he was serving all of us by the spoonful. Some videos don't age well. Have a look at this.
Dr. Wansink is an influencer. Are you?
These guys are. Let's all raise our glasses to the data detectives who understand how science should be done. My recommendation this week is twofold. First, if you're interested in this Brian Wansink story, I would invite you to check out the continuing coverage by Stephanie Lee for BuzzFeed News. You'll find the links in the video description. But beyond Wansink himself, there is a great featured article that came out 2 years ago on the website of the journal Nature. It's by Regina Nuzzo, and it's about how scientists fool themselves and how they can stop. It details interesting solutions to this problem of bad science, such as the idea of getting a journal to accept your study for publication before the results are in, strictly on the basis of your methodology and analysis plan. Highly recommended. This video series is one small part of what our office does, so go to mcgill.ca/OSS to see what else we do to help separate sense from nonsense. You can follow me on Twitter, @CrackedScience, and I will see you soon for more cracked science.